Welcome to NOAA Live Alaska. My name is Lisa Hiruki-Raring and I'm going to be moderating today's webinar. This series is a collaborative effort by NOAA Fisheries Alaska Fisheries Science Center, where I work, NOAA's Alaska Regional Collaboration Network, and NOAA's National Weather Service. I wanted to introduce my co-coordinator, Story Oates, who's helping me behind the scenes, and our two interns, Emma and Elizabeth, who will also be helping us behind the scenes. So if you see their names responding to your questions or comments, now you know their faces as well. This webinar series is designed to help you to get to know NOAA's work in Alaska, our partners, and the communities we work with in Alaska, and how we connect with your communities. NOAA, the National Oceanic and Atmospheric Administration, studies the ocean and the atmosphere and where the two meet, from weather to ocean to the animals that live around us. This school year, we're presenting a short series of webinars that are more regionally based so that we can focus on topics of interest to those regions of Alaska. We're aiming to present perspectives from the communities we work with, as well as research conducted by students, in addition to established scientists. We hope that this gives you a look at different communities, as well as different career paths you might be interested in. Today, we're starting our webinar series for the Northwest Arctic with a presentation by my colleague, Mabel Baldwin-Schaeffer, who works at the NOAA Fisheries Alaska Fisheries Science Center with me. While we'll be talking about NOAA's and partners' role in research and stewardship, we want to recognize that we're all coming to you from the traditional lands of Indigenous communities who have substantial traditional and local knowledge and much to share with us. We acknowledge that Mabel's work for her master's study was done in the eastern and northern Bering Sea in Alaska, the traditional lands of the Inupiat, Yupik, and Siberian Yupik, who have stewarded their lands and waters for thousands of years. We're indebted to their wisdom and the knowledge of their lands and waters. Mabel's current work for the Alaska Fisheries Science Center is in Alaska coastal communities, which are the traditional homelands of the Inupiat, Yupik, Siberian Yupik people, Nunga, Aleutik Sugbiak, Iyak, Tlingit, Haida, and Tsimshian peoples. Mabel is presenting from Benta or Wasilla, the ancestral lands of the Denaina and Atna people who have stewarded this area for thousands of years. The community thrives thanks to their continued sharing of vision, wisdom, values, and leadership. We'd also like to acknowledge that we're hosting this webinar from the traditional lands of the Coast Salish, including the First People of Seattle, the Duwamish people past and present. A few guidelines before I hand you over to Mabel. You're all muted because we have a lot of people on the line and we want to make sure that everyone can hear our speaker. However, there's a box where you can write questions and we encourage you to ask them as we go. My colleague Story and our interns Elizabeth and Emma and I will be keeping track for Mabel. She'll stop every now and again and answer a few questions. We may not get to all of our questions, but we'll try to answer as many as we can. Okay, I'll hand it over to Mabel to introduce herself.
Thank you, Lisa. Welcome to NOAA Live Alaska. Translated into English, I said hello and I introduced myself with my Inupiat Eskimo name. And the title of my presentation is translated in English is For the Purpose of a Good Life. Next slide. I was born and raised in the native village of Kayana, where I'm a tribal member. In Inupiat, Kayana is traditionally referred to as Katyak, meaning where three rivers meet. And I'll get to that at the very end of the slide. Katyak is one of 11 regions in the Northwest Arctic region, all of which are above the Arctic Circle. And this region has been occupied by Inupiat people for at least 10,000 years. Next slide. It's customary by Alaska Natives and American Indians to introduce your parents and grandparents. In Inupiat, we call our fathers Apa and our mothers Aka. My Aka is Eva and her Inupiat name is Akimayuk. My dad, Clyde Sr., is Ukaleen. In Inupiat, we call our grandmas Anas and our grandfathers Tata. My maternal Anna is Pauline, and my maternal Tata is Bert. Now, these are their given English names. Their Inupiat names are Sikopserak and Immuk. My paternal Anna's name is Lucy, and her Inupiat name is Tulipuk. My paternal grandfather, Harry, was a non-native second generation immigrant from Ireland. Next slide. I was raised in an AFAP, a small way of life, and what this means is that the lifestyle is heavily dependent on the subsistence harvest of marine mammals, land animals, fish, and migratory birds. In the top right is a bearded seal. In Inupiaq, we call it Ugruk. To the right is a caribou. In Inupiaq, we call it Tutu. On the bottom left is fish. That is Kaluk. And the bottom right is a migratory bird, and that is referred to as Dingmita. These are some of what Eskimos or Inupiaq Eskimos harvest. Next slide. Some of those prepared Inupiaq Eskimo foods look like this. And some of these foods include dried salmon, bearded seal, beluga whale, bowhead whale, salmon eggs, and seal oil. Rich in fatty acids and high in protein and iron and full of nutrients, our food consists of animals, berries, and plants geographic to our regions. When we go hunt, fish, and gather, we basically are going to the grocery store, and I want to emphasize that subsistence, however, does not only function as food. I won't go into detail on this topic today. However, Kotzebue resident and Inupiaq Eskimo hunter Lance Kalura Kramer will discuss the importance of subsistence to the Inupiaq next week on the 8th. Next slide. Eskimo or Inupiaq Eskimos are one type of Eskimo in Alaska. However, there are other Eskimos in Alaska. And when I use the term Eskimo, I use it almost as an umbrella term for other Eskimos in Alaska. And other types of Eskimos in Alaska include Tsleil-Waututh, Central Yupik, Chupik, St. Lawrence Island, Yupik, and Aleutian. Next slide. A common misconception is that all Alaska natives are Eskimo. In reality, there are 20 broad cultures spanning over 200 tribes. On the map in blue are where Eskimos reside. Next slide. So Eskimos are not secluded to Western Alaska. They also live in other circumpolar regions, including Russia, Canada, and Greenland. This is the map as if you were looking down at the top of the planet. Next slide. Or I guess I should give viewers a chance to like look at the map, right? So So my Inupiaq Eskimo village is one that encompasses Western Alaska. My village, Kayana, is depicted by the red dot. It's a remote village far from the road system. And this is typical for the majority of rural and indigenous communities. Essential items, including non-subsistence foods and fuel, are flown in through air cargo to the regional hub, which is Kotzebue, and then hauled in on small aircraft or barged in during the summer. Next slide. With that said, to get to these villages, including Kayana, you must fly in on small aircraft, snow machine in the winter, or boat in the summer. Next slide. I covered how it's customary to introduce your parents and grandparents, touched a little on the Inupiaq Eskimo lifestyle and types of Eskimos in Alaska and where other Eskimos live beyond Alaska. So far, do you have any questions?
So if you have any questions for Mabel, be sure to type them into your question box and go through them. We did have a question about, you were talking about how in Kayana, you could only get there by plane or by boat, or by other means other than like driving. And so we were wondering, how much more expensive is grocery store food? Like if you were just to get a box of mac and cheese or something at the store in Kayana versus how expensive it is where you live now in Wasilla.
Okay, so let's maybe divert to a gallon of milk, which is nearly $15.
Wow, that's very expensive.
And then to go off of that, I mean, items like that are very minimal and they don't last very long on the shelves.
I bet there must be a sort of whisper network of when a plane comes in with food, everybody says, oh, there's this kind of food at the store and everybody goes to get it. Does that kind of happen when you're at home? We did have a question from Allison Paul who said, when Eskimos write in their native languages, do they use the same alphabet as we do for English?
No, there are special characters. For like the L's have special characters and they sound different. The N's have special characters and they sound different. And the G's.
And I think another thing that you had touched on when you showed a map of Alaska is that there are many different Alaska Native cultures in Alaska, and each of them have their own characters and letters that they use in their languages as well?
Yes, good question. Yes, they do. And I'm not very knowledgeable on that, but I know for a fact that they do have special characters.
Thanks. Kilali was wondering, what is your favorite traditional food to eat?
My favorite traditional food to eat is, it's not cooked. So when you freshly catch a trout, you throw it in the freezer. And my favorite is trout. And so frozen fish is called kok. So that's my favorite, with seal oil.
And what exactly, how do you prepare seal oil?
I'm gonna let you wait for Lance to explain that.
That sounds like a good idea. Okay, so Michelle had one other question. Oh, did you have something else, Mabel?
Yeah, well, only because I grew up on the river and seals are harvested on the coast.
Right. So actually that brings up a point from last week's webinar, because Tonya, when she went to St. Lawrence Island, said that there were a lot of people who were interested in trading her dried fish for their muktuk, because the environment on St. Lawrence Island was damp enough that they couldn't dry fish the way that the community members in Tonya's hometown were able to. And so so they had different types of traditional foods that they were able to trade for the dried fish that she brought. And so I was wondering, for your home community in Kayana, were there particular things that you might trade with other folks from other communities, like seal oil versus other things?
Yeah, so in Kotzebue, that was a typical area where people from the inland come to share different foods and do some trading.
Great. Michelle was also wondering, is there a school in the community that you grew up in?
Yes, it is a K through 12 school, all in the same building. The village where I grew up in averaged on four decades now was a population of 400.
Great. Well, I know that you would like to talk a little bit more about the projects that you've worked on. So maybe we should go on to the next section and see what kind of information we can get.
Thank you. Okay, so I want to transition into my educational background, what I have previously worked on and what I do now. My educational background includes a Bachelor of Arts in Sustainability Studies and a Master of Science in Environmental Science, both of which I have received at the Alaska Pacific University located in Anchorage, Alaska. And near and dear to my heart has always been to improve local participation and to engage Alaskan communities in research development. And this is largely due to my traditional lifestyle upbringing and the continuance of Alaska Native livelihoods is important to me. Next slide. In my previous work, I led a study looking at a mining impact study in Norton Sound and whether that may have an overlap with red king crab habitat. I have also managed a collaborative initiative between Bering Sea elders and a Bering Sea commercial fishing fleet to better understand seasonal timing of their subsistence and commercial fisheries in Kuskokwim Bay. I won't cover too much on the science of those studies. I mostly want to emphasize why those two Bering Sea projects were what I considered successful. Next slide. You must have heard or even watched the show called Bering Sea Gold on the Discovery Channel. These are types of marine operations I'm referring to. If you have not seen the show, I have included a couple of different types. One that is basically a type that vacuums the bottom of the ocean, and the other scooping it out with the goal to shake out dirt that is not gold. My study basically was looking to see if mining areas overlap with rocky areas. And just to give you a little background, red king crab females release their eggs near shore. And for the first several years, these baby crabs, we call them juveniles, use these areas to live. And while so, they require rocky areas and areas that have vegetation, so they are sheltered from predators. We use this 7-foot remote operated craft, basically a water drone with special cameras to look at the bottom of the ocean in 2014. And then again, the same craft and cameras in 2015 to see how different it is after a year's worth of waves, currents, and high intensity storms. Next slide. I played a key role in identifying and recruiting a diverse area of participants to develop a meaningful composite of perceptions and viewpoints, and these included the Alaska Department of Fish and Game staff from NOAA, Norton Sound Economic Development Corporation staff, NOAA Habitat Division, Alaska Fisheries Science Center staff, tribal organizations, local fishermen, Norton Sound gold miners, and researchers from Alaska Pacific University and Florida International University. Next slide. Hopefully I was able to explain the Norton Sound study well enough. Do you have any questions?
So we had, there was a question about the water drone. I was wondering whether you could tell us a little bit about the water drone and what you were doing with it, and whether it was difficult to program. Did you have to learn how to program it to go where you wanted it to go?
Yes, good question. So the water drone had two different acoustic cameras, and if you're familiar with maybe what an ultrasound is, like, so it uses sound to bounce back to display a type of image. And then, so what we did was basically map the bottom to calculate cobble versus sand areas and how those changed over a year.
Wow, that sounds really cool. And again, if you have any other questions, please remember to put them into your question box as you're asking them. We did have a question from Texas, and he wanted to know, did you discover if the mining was affecting the red king crab habitat?
Well, that was, I would encourage future researchers to survey in deeper waters, because the areas that we did survey were in shallower waters. And what we found was that natural effects overpowered mining effects. So there was like a reset, maybe.
Was there a lot of overlap between the juvenile habitat and the mining operations?
I can't answer that. It started off as a crab study, and then ended up as a mining impact study, and then ended up as a study where we tested to see if we could successfully map seabed complexity.
So it kind of, the purpose of the study kept on shifting, it sounded like.
Yeah, yes.
And that is actually a lot of a good lesson on what happens with research. Sometimes you start out with one question and it kind of moves into other questions. We did have, there was a question also on, you had a slide that showed a lot of different groups and how you were getting the viewpoint and inputs from all of the different groups. And the question was it difficult to get everybody at the same table, or was there a lot of different viewpoints that it was, or was your role more to collect that information rather than to get them all talking to each other?
I'll say that a lot of the participants within the slide were at odds with each other, but I will cover that later. In the presentation.
And Mabel and Ruby had a question about whether, maybe you'll cover this a little later as well. They were wondering whether the mine study was controversial or whether it was something where you were doing research and it, that several, many people wanted.
It is a resource use conflict with essential fish habitat and rain gold mining, both of which are natural resources.
Right. So anytime you have a conflict, you're going to have different viewpoints. So that's where your skill of bringing different groups together, I think, is a really valuable one to get everybody talking together, I think. Mabel and Ruby actually had a second question, and this goes back to your first section of your talk where you were talking about your growing up time, and they were wondering whether you had noticed any effects from climate change in your village.
Not when I was growing up. I think they're trying to age me or something.
Maybe so. So maybe a better way to ask it is, when you go back to visit now, do you notice changes from when you were growing up, or when your father, when you're from your father's stories or your grandparents' stories? Oh, Mabel, I think that we lost your audio. It seems like we might have a little bit of a bad connection. So maybe we should hold questions at this point. Mabel, are you able to hear us okay?
Yes, I could hear you. Okay. Are we done with questions, or do you want to move on to the Kuskokwim Bay?
Yeah, let's move on to the next one.
Okay, so my research in the Kuskokwim Bay included another resource use conflict, which included commercial and subsistence fisheries, as opposed to essential fish habitat and marine gold mining. So here in Kuskokwim Bay, yellowfin sole commercial fishermen have used temperature data to help them decide where to fish, and this benefits not only the efficiency of fishing, but also minimizes the accidental catching of halibut and salmon, which we call bycatch. I was responsible for reaching out to local fishermen in Kuskokwim Bay to seek out input on gear design and where they would like to place these setups, and which were made out of typical fishing gear and used by local fishermen, which then these small temperature data loggers were attached. I was responsible for making arrangements with local boat captains for the deployment and retrieval of these setups, and lastly, to prepare data for statistical work and sharing that information with my availability for any questions that they may have. Next slide. And then so I established a network of partners, including Bering Sea elders, commercial fishermen, local fishermen, and scientists from Alaska Pacific University to, with the goal, I should say, to minimize effects on local fisheries. Working with Indigenous and local residents who are not Indigenous is important because they hold rich ecological knowledge, and this is, so to speak, that they live there and they see all these changes like firsthand. And then so while these two Bering Sea projects are quite different, the approaches were quite similar. Building on my work in Norton Sound, I've utilized the same important concepts to help establish and foster collaborative relationships in the Kuskokwim Bay area. To name a few, but are not limited to, they include being familiar with the culture, frequent visits to the villages, frequent sharing of information, and working together throughout all stages of the project. And we want to ensure stakeholders and their ideas are part of their research project, or process, sorry. Next slide. So I've discussed commercial fishing and bycatch, my network of partners in Kuskokwim Bay, and how that project was similar to my previous Norton Sound work. Do you have any questions?
So one of the questions that we had is that how are temperatures used in deciding where to fish?
The warmer, I guess, for different, or yellowfin sole in particular, are where they would like to temperatures differ between different fish types.
So depending on what the temperature is, then they can target the kind of fish that the location of the fish that they want to catch. Is that?
Yeah, and then so yellowfin sole is a ground fish. So what we were doing was looking at temperatures in the on the very bottom of the ocean. And then so we during that study, we put one of those data loggers on the very bottom. We put a data logger in the very middle, and we put a data logger on the very top. And then so what we did was compared all of those data, and we through time, like from day to day and from one location to the next. And then we also compared that to our NOAA satellite data. And then what we found was that they were very, very similar, like to the 0.3 degrees. So we wanted to see if we could rely on NOAA satellite data. And
great.
I
wanted to remind our viewers, if you have any other questions about the temperature study, please go ahead and put them in the question box. We did have another question about how did you use the information from the Bering Sea Elders Group in this Kuskokwim Bay study along with the temperatures?
I'm sorry, could you repeat that?
The question was just how the traditional knowledge information from the Bering Sea Elders Group was used along with the temperature study in the temperature study, because the purpose of the temperature study was to look at where fishermen were fishing and whether you could look at NOAA satellite temperature data to see whether they could whether they were the same temperatures as what you were logging on the water. But the question was, how did the elders traditional data get incorporated into what your temperature study was?
Yeah, so in this project, we didn't use traditional knowledge. We used local participation, and that included local boat captains and local gear designers.
Okay. So was that you had mentioned that with the Bering Sea Elders Group, you talked to them about design and
To place the buoys.
Where to place the buoys. Right. So that's very interesting. Do you think that they provided a lot of different input into where the fish that you were targeting typically were caught? When you were looking at the temperatures?
No. I'm sorry, I can't answer that question.
Oh, that's okay. I think that it was, I probably
phrased
it in a little bit convoluted way. I think the question was just more how the information was incorporated, and I think you answered that it was more talking to the elders about and boat captains about where to place the buoys and how to design the buoys. So great. Well, I know you have one more section to go through, so maybe we can move into the next section.
Okay, so as of May this year, I joined the Alaska Fisheries Science Center communications team as the tribal research coordinator, and my job is to lead efforts to build partnerships between tribal communities and NOAA fishery scientists, and to identify where we at NOAA can do better and working in education and outreach. While we all work within the same department, our jobs are fairly unique. Next slide. And then so through building partnerships, education, outreach, sharing media relations and publications, we aim to strengthen science within Alaska's dynamic waters. Next slide. And I'd like to invite young generations and older generations, urban and rural areas, native and non-native participants, basically individuals, to come together similar to the same where three rivers meet. And then so there are many challenges within developing effective collaborative partnerships with Alaskan Indigenous communities, but there are way more benefits to why we need to do it, especially with the rapidly changing climate in the Arctic. And our researchers hope to work with tribes and to identify research projects that benefit both Alaskan community interests and NOAA Fisheries science mission to better inform our understanding and to respond to the marine ecosystem changes. And I want to close with the name of the presentation title, For the Purpose of a Good Life. I'd like to think that the purpose of research, including my work, is to improve the quality of life for future generations. And with that, I'll take any questions that you might have.
Great.
I know we're ahead of schedule, so there might be
questions. Thank you so much for going over all of your different research projects and I especially think that it's that what you were talking about with respect to the title of your talk was very meaningful, because I do think that, you know, the purpose of the research that we do is to be stewards of our environment and make it for a better life for all of the people who are living in the areas where we are trying to find out more knowledge. And I really respect the way that your studies have incorporated partnering with the communities to get input from all of the different people that are involved. And I think that's something that we would really like to our students to take away as well. So if you have any questions, just be sure to put them into the chat, and we'll answer as many as we can. We did have a question about what was the favorite part of either of the two research projects that you talked about just now?
The favorite part of both projects, just being in rural Alaska, is like being home. So I enjoy being in rural Alaska, and I don't get the chance to go home much often beyond like field work.
I would imagine that it would be a lot of fun to talk to so many different people and get their input on different
places. And that, sorry.
So do you think that will also translate into what you're doing now in your current job?
Once the pandemic lifts, I'm really looking forward to being in rural communities and talking to elders and local residents.
Great. One of the questions that we had going back to your mining impact study is whether, is there a lot of gold that's found in the area that you were doing your study?
Um, It depends. I mean, like when I was doing my study, and I'm not going to talk about the amount of gold, but the amount of operations that were in the area. And so the number of operations increased significantly based on several reasons. In, one, including the Bering Sea Gold Show. I mean, it targeted Nome, Alaska on a map because of the show. Not only that, there were several other factors that increased the number of operations in Norton Sound. One being the opening of access and allowing permits and
We did have another question about whether, like, what defines, can, would you be able to define who is an elder in a community? And whether, how can you tell who's an elder?
I think that varies between one culture to the next. I really think it varies from one culture to the next.
Let's see, Leanne was asking, did anything surprise you in the studies that you were doing, either in working with local stakeholders or in the results from the studies?
No, there was nothing surprising.
Okay, and then Mabel and Ruby were wondering whether there were in any interesting elder stories that you'd feel comfortable sharing with us about the from the times that you were talking about your studies.
Could you repeat that? And a lot of my work included like logistics. I pretty much was sitting on the beach. A lot of my work didn't include visiting people in their homes.
So Mabel and Ruby had, just to reword what I had said before, Mabel and Ruby were wondering whether there were any interesting stories that you heard from the elders that you'd be comfortable sharing with us, or whether so whether there might be interesting stories that stick out in your mind.
Yeah, so Ruby, a lot of my work included logistics and working out technical aspects. When I was in the communities, I was not visiting people in their homes.
Okay, and then John was wondering, growing up in Kiana, he was wondering whether you could share one of your favorite memories venturing out and especially learning how to subsist in such a remote area.
Yeah, so my earliest childhood memories actually included practicing subsistence. My family would leave the village for a whole summer's worth and join our cousins and our aunties. And it was kind of like a family reunion, pretty much, for a whole summer. And I think that would be like my favorite part.
How long were you, was it for the whole summer that you were out?
Yes.
That sounds like a good, a really good time to be spending outside, learning all the different techniques. I remember talking to one of our colleagues up in Nome, and she was talking about going to fish camp every summer, and that she really enjoyed just helping out in different roles around the camps. And So I think that those kinds of memories often are what ground us once we've become adults. Okay, I think that one of the questions that we had was about the Kuskokwim Bay study, where you were talking with the community, and you had mentioned four different points about your research process, and they were wondering whether you could repeat them. One was familiarity with culture and working together, but she was wondering whether you could repeat those points that you had made.
Okay. Yes. Going back to both projects and the successful nest, I guess you should say, between those two, that's one of the things that I worked on too, like other than the Norton Sound Red King Crab study. So I looked at past research and barriers that maybe researchers came about. And then so we identified a list of themes. And then so going back to the ones that I did mention that would help build partnerships, I guess, were to being familiar with the culture, frequent visits to the village, frequent sharing of information, and working together throughout all stages of the process.
So one of the things that you had mentioned is that with it being COVID times right now, that could be, that's difficult to do right now because we can't visit villages. So that must be one of the difficulties that you would face in your position right now, in that it's harder to follow up and do frequent visits when we're in a situation where we can't travel.
Absolutely. And then so to fill that lag time of communication, I try to avoid emailing. I more so would, you know, like have a conversation with the people with the ties to communities, rather than more so talk less about business or projects and just have a conversation, you know, get to know them, build a little bit of trust.
That sounds like something that all of us could do. I think it's important to have that person-to-person contact, I think, to build relationships. One of our other viewers were asking whether you might be able to talk a little bit about any current projects that you might be working on.
I'm helping several projects. We're looking at another mining impact study in the same area, not so much to do with salmon, but our crab, but more so to do with salmon. I'm helping assist on projects like the regional action plan, which is a 5-year plan to identify research priorities in the different regions, including Bering Strait, the Northwest Arctic, and the North Slope. Participating on a panel within the Bering Strait region. Those are to name a few. I've been like super, super busy. Fridays come really fast.
Yes, I can imagine. I was also wondering whether, I mean, I know that when we've been talking about reaching out to communities in our communications group, there are things that I think those of us who are used to reliable internet connection, we don't realize about communicating with other remote communities. And I was wondering whether you might talk about some of the difficulties that folks might have when you're trying to reach out to communicate with them when you can't go and be there in person.
Okay. So even without COVID, I would encourage researchers to use more than one way of communication. I mean, like, say you email, but you also would like to fax. And then going off of that, I mean, not everybody has like computer access or internet access. So faxing, people might think is obsolete, but that's like the main communication to get information out to the villages. So yeah, two ways of communication, faxing, and then the tribal organizations there after could post these notices and regular areas where local residents could see, and maybe call in does that answer?
Yeah, I think that sometimes we assume that if we put things out on the computer that everybody can reach them, and it's sometimes you need to realize that you need to try other ways. And it really resonates, I think, with us when you talk about how rather than emailing, you would rather pick up the phone and call and make a personal connection with folks when you can't go visit in person. And I think that's something that's very important in those communities. One last question for us, I think, and before we finish up, we were wondering whether you have any advice for young scientists based on your experiences in growing up and going to school and now working here at NOAA.
So I don't have words of encouragement specifically to future scientists. It's more like a general word of encouragement, and that is to mistakes have to happen, and don't be afraid to face challenges, and lastly, to dream big.
Great. And I think that, you know, a lot of people can be inspired by, you know, the way that you've demonstrated that you can do a lot of different things and use a lot of the skills that you have developed over the different research projects that you've done and apply them to new situations. And I think that can be said for a lot of different things. So, you know, one of the things that we always talk to students about is that, you know, remember that when you're working in groups at school, it's not just a school project. It's learning skills for working in groups once you get out of school and work with groups at your workplace. And a lot of the times we don't emphasize that to students is the skills that you're learning now can be applied through your life. And I really appreciate you talking about that, learning from your mistakes and also dreaming big and reaching out to what you would like to do. So thank you so much, Mabel. I really appreciate you coming in and giving a presentation for us. And thank you to all of our viewers for being on the line, and hope you can join us next week. We're going to have Lance Kramer talking about traditional ecological knowledge, and we hope to see you back next week. So thanks very much. Thanks, Mabel. Thanks to our viewers, and we'll see you next week. Bye-bye.